Hey, good afternoon, everybody. This is Andy, and I'd like to welcome you to this Tuesday edition of Coding with Andy, I guess. This is my stream. Welcome. Wearing my SQL Saturday hat, from the SQL Saturday number 564. It was the 10th anniversary in 2016 of the Orlando SQL Saturday. My good friend Andy Warren and his crew were hosting that. Today, I'm just sharing a little bit more about SSIS Framework Manager. This is a new version. I'll pop up here so you can see. This one is named SSIS Framework Manager CE. The CE is for Community Edition. Let's pop over to captions here real quick. You can pop into DIL Suite and check these out for yourself. There's a few products there we sell, including versions of the framework, but only one of them is free, and it's named SSIS Framework Community Edition. There it is right there. But there's some other editions you can check out while you're there. The other thing that we sell on this page is SSIS Catalog Compare. There is no free or trial version of this. But if you're interested in learning about the functionality of SSIS Catalog Compare, you can check out the viewer here in SSIS Catalog Browser. That is free, not open source. The Framework Community Edition is both. It's free and open source. And some of you have been following me as I built a version of the Framework Manager for the commercial editions of the framework. It's the table names are subtly different between community and these non-community editions here. A lot more functionality, as you can see there. Some asked, would I create a framework manager for the community edition? And my first response was, well, sure. But in my mind, I'm thinking, yeah, later. But I've been working on it. And it's kind of in the middle. I started out with a code that's already available here in the commercial version. I've got a new instance here named VDemo Andy. Yes, I am that vein. And what I'm working through right now is the an application package to this. That's odd. It's not showing that. Why aren't you showing that? I clearly clicked on you. Okay, there it is. Don't know what happened there, but the part that I'm working through right now, I made a lot of changes to this, obviously. For this, it's more than just the names of the tables that are involved. It's also the functionality. You can see there's a lot of functionality not showing up, and because it doesn't exist in the free version. And people, you know, ask me all the time, well, Andy, what if people want that functionality? And I have an excellent answer for that. It's by the version that has that functionality. That's not very nice. So I'm looking at adding an application package to this. And let's pop over here and make sure it exists. And it does. Okay, it's got the application package there. So that's curious. And then I'm going to refresh the application. I kind of want to zoom out here. I thought I wanted to zoom out here. Yep, let's do that. And I don't see it over here yet. That's what was kind of throwing me. So when I don't have a selected application package here right now. So I just came from one of these refresh applications here. I want to say add application package. Yeah, that sounds like the right one. That's where I am now. I'm coming from main. So what if, what's throwing me here, I think, is the selected application package. I think that might be the problem. And why is that fussing? Not really. Let's do this again. Let's start over and see what we get here. Let me pop over to chat, see if anybody's chatting with me. Nobody yet, but that's okay. The chat hasn't been working on Restream here an awful lot. And I don't plan to stay on here for hours on end like I have in the past. I just plan to be on for a little bit. So let's pick up child one, add it, and set added from false to true, add it to the collection. Right now there are zero packages in the application packages of the selected application. If we look at that again, now we should have one, and we do. Selected application packages, no, let's go ahead and select that one. And then let's just F5, let's see what happens. It shows up. All right, what happens when we click on it? It's throwing an exception, object not sent to an instance. Yada, yada, yada. Okay, what exactly is your problem here? Let's try that again. Control Shift F5, we'll restart it. Hope everybody's having a good time. I sure am. You see, it's almost like it's not persisting it. And I think that's, you know, the reason it's not doing that, I don't think it's persisting it. So what happens if, let's run down here to surface application, run to cursor. We still got our selected application, our selected app application. So there's some wonkiness that I put in here or to address. If it's null, set it. Yeah, I think I had this different. I think I know why now I had it different. Let's go back to there. Yeah. So once I've got it set, I want to do this after. If it's null, I want to go ahead and set it. And then after that, I want to fill in these blanks. Okay, there's that. And yeah, we're done. Okay, so it's in there. The problem, it blew up when I clicked on child one. So let's click on the application first. Seems like it's got the application stuff working and it's copacetic. I'm going to pause and then step into the next statement here and then click this. I want to see what it does. So I want to get down here where I can see my values. My selected application package is null. I think I know why that happened. Tree node. Yeah, I've already got this. So I think what I'm kind of bouncing around here. I don't know if I should do that or not. I think I should do that down here. I'm not sure. That's interesting. It sets it again. I know why I did that. That's not part of the original app. Yeah, so here's the problem, I think. Let's look at the tag. Yeah, it's still set to negative one. So what it did not do, and maybe it didn't do it because I didn't tell it to do it. Let's make sure I told it to do it. Let's restart. I didn't persist it. It is not persisted. Let's say it that way. And maybe the reason it is not persisted is because I did not persist it. Whose fault is that? Mine. My fault. Go ahead. I'm liking what you're doing here. And then if I click save, what does it look like? Yeah, it has an application package ID. Okay. So let's break it again. Let's add child two. And then before we save it, let's click on it. And I think what I want to do in here go ahead and get the application package ID. And if it's negative, and it will be, if it's less than zero, I'll do this. There. All right, so what do I want to do if it's less than zero? I think I want to send a message. Yeah, I think I'll just let's do this. And let's set this equal to and grab the text. Yep, child two. Has not yet been stored. That's going to put a space in after. Please store. Please save. There's that. And then we want to pop up a message box saying that message. Show. And we'll have it say message. We'll make it owned by this form. Then we'll say message. Then we'll have a caption. For caption, and I think we can do buttons. Yes, message box buttons dot okay. Okay, and then after this, we have a save button in here. Let's go ahead and set the focus to that so that you could, if you want, you could just click the space bar. Control shift 10 sets it to this if I don't have an error, and whoop. I don't. All right, let's walk it through here. Hector. Hector's one of the people who said yes, great, in the comments. Hector is one who asked me about doing this. I decided to do it, Hector, for you. And actually, it was quite a few people pinged me about this and said, hey, why don't you just go do this thing? Okay. There's my application not yet saved. Probably need to put an icon on that as well. Maybe like an information icon. Let's click OK. I think that's the next argument. Let's see. Yep, message box icon dot information. Let's do that. How's that? Pop back up to there. Run it again. F11. I like it. Now you have been stored. Please save the application before proceeding. It even says please. We're going to set the focus to the button save. It's going to do the rest of this. Okay, so I'm going to stop here because what I want to do is make me a new Boolean here, and I'm going to set it to that. And the Boolean is going to be called OK to proceed. Now I need to return to this, go to the definition, and right now it's not defined as a Boolean. Now it is. And let's see. Just a second. I don't want you hearing my phone dinging, and it's going to, see, it's still dinging. Okay, there. Now you may hear it vibrate, but maybe not. Okay, so outside of the try here, we'll do a bool return. And we'll initialize it as false. And then down here, when we're done, I could probably get away with doing it here since it's initialized, and I think I shall. Let's see if that's okay. See if it fusses at me for not returning all paths, and it doesn't, so I'm okay. Button save focus. Yeah, okay. Here's where I want to set it to true. Rep equals true. That's if, actually I'll do it after that just to make sure that succeeds. Goes and gets this. Try this again. Pop through here. And you can see how messy that code is with me. Pardon me. All of that commented out stuff. Because there's just a lot of things, a lot of use cases I had to consider. Because there's, I don't know, there's easily four times as many properties in the not free version of this. excuse me. I'm going to go ahead and just kind of step through the refresh here. And let's see. Now, this is the populate. We'll run to the cursor there. And I'm not going to go through all of the logging here. The logging is set to maximum. That's why I'm skipping it. Okay, pop in here. All right. Run. What am I doing? I think I'm surfacing here. That's the... Skip that. Run to cursor. Expand all and then surface application. Okay. And then for some reason I thought I was going to get into that other thing. Okay, now when we click on that, that's what it is. I gotta click on it. Here we go. Little parser here to give me back the value between, and so it is negative. Okay, that's exactly what I wanted it to do. And if I click on another one, I'm going to take that off for now. I think it looks spooty. I like the splitter. It was way much more trouble than it should have been. When I click on child 2, it should give me that, and it does. Okay. Then it shows me, which is nice, it doesn't fail. It just tells me why this is negative. Let's save it. Now I got a 5. Okay, let's see if we can build one from scratch. Let's do app 5 and save. And then on app 5, let's add child 1. Let's add child 2. And child 3. Now let's move these around a little bit. Okay. It's going to be a little obnoxious. Interesting. It didn't select it. I kind of need it to. We'll be all right. Persisted execution order. That's kind of. Oh, it's on 3. That's why. Okay. Let's save it. That's looking good. Can I move up and down? Absolutely, I can. Okay. I think I want that same note when I build it. And before I run the execute, let's go to the catalog here. Because, yeah, I think I'm going to give away the execute as well. I know, I'm a big old softy. Let's look at the report. All executions. By the way, I just wrote a blog post about this query. A friend reached out to me on LinkedIn and said, hey, how do you do this thing? I want to do this thing. And it was an interesting problem they were trying to solve. And I said, okay. The answer is, I don't know. Let's begin there. But here's how I would start. And I kind of walked them through a query and said, go look at the metadata and sys comments and see, you know, what calls this. And that way you can get how the catalog, it was about the catalog. Then you can get how the catalog does this. Anyway, it's out there. It's over at andylunder.blog. And it's called, I think it's called One Good Question. Let's see. Yep, One Good Question. Big old ugly blue question mark as the image. And this is important. Don't like the big old blue question mark on my post here. Don't use it on your blogs. Just saying. Okay, but yeah, fun stuff there. And while I'm here, we'll take a sponsor break. It's not my blog. Great. Not ENT, ENTDNA. I thought I'd typed that in here before. I guess I hadn't. And I have some classes coming up in a couple of weeks from zero to SSIS. These classes cost money. On following that, I think, is that Tuesday and Wednesday? I'm not positive of that. Maybe it's, no, it's Monday and Tuesday. That's 7 days later. Expert SSIS. On Wednesday, following that, Master the SSIS Catalog. Thursday, I've got Master the Fundamentals of Azure Data Factory. And you can click on each of these links to learn more about it. You can click on Register. Actually, you can click on these links like for Master the ADF, Master the Fundamentals of ADF. You click on that, see the price, you can buy it. And then you get an email that tells you to be sure to go out and register. I think these are great classes, but I'm really biased. I wrote them. You can learn, you know, you can learn a lot. If you're just getting into SSIS, this will get you a good solid grounding in SSIS. And we actually cover some of the topics that are covered in some of these other courses as well in there. If you're going to do that though, especially if you're going to do the, you know, from zero to SSIS, because it costs $4,000, $39.99. If you're going to do that, please consider the season pass. And each of my classes, right now, they're priced at about $9.99 per student per day. The season pass is just under $6,000. But not only do you get to attend all four of those classes, which come in at around, around $8,000, you can get that for $6,000. You can also attend all of the other deliveries of these classes if you'd like. If you want to go to different, you know, deliveries of it. And you say, well, Andy, why would anybody want to go to different deliveries? Well, especially in the case of Azure Data Factory, this changes. And I update the material to try and keep up. I don't always. I at the beginning of that class, there's a disclaimer that it changes every time, literally every day. And we're going to see something new, and that happens. These others, though, I cover the same slides, and in the case of from zero to SSIS, there's over 12 labs that you do as part of that. But I always deliver them ad hoc. I'm not reading from a script. I'm sharing from experience, and I'll guarantee you by Q4, I will have had more experiences and they'll be fresh on my mind and I'll be sharing those with you. You can go to all of these if you'd like. It's a important caveat that if I don't have enough people signed up for a course, I'll just move people to the next delivery. I do that. It's rare, but it happens, especially with the newer courses that are just catching on. But there's that, and then also all recordings for a full year. You can look at, you can view the recordings of these four classes, and this is much more economical. Right now, it's only $500, I believe. Yep, $497 for a year of that. And so, jump in. The water's fine. So, what I'm back to the to here. I don't have any executions set up yet, but if I right click and click execute, we should see some executions pop up here. This is a framework after all, or not. It'd be interesting to see what's going on here. So what happened when I right-clicked and clicked execute? Let's pop over to this and check it out. Well, let's see. It's not going to work that way. I can't quite do it that way. There we go. That's the one I'm after. Woot! Go to definition, and let's set a breakpoint there. Let's nuke through all other breakpoints and set that one there. There we go. All right. Back here, right-click, execute. Oh, I got to go continue first. Right-click, execute, and here we are. Is the selected node null? It is not. It's child one. Well, that's not right. Selected node is app 5. Yeah, and I need to do a double check in here to see. This is what's getting me in trouble. If tvfw.selectedNode.image equals 2, that is an application. That's what's throwing me. I can bet you real money. And let's go down to the end of this using here. All right, back up to the top here. Equal. Gosh, that's an old VB mistake. Custom, and it should be running, the stored procs are named the same. Well, there's only two in here, but there's like, I don't know, 50 in the commercial versions. App name, is that right? You know what? I bet that's not right. Let's zoom out. Let's go back over here because I think I did name the parameter different. And you may say, Andy, that was stupid. And I would almost agree with you, but that's why I'm building a whole new application for this. There are subtle and not-so-subtle differences. Yep, application underscore name. Believe it or not, well, I'm almost positive this is case-sensitive. Let's just run that and see what it's doing now. What if we go back to here and execute that? Boom, look, it's running. So what are we running? We're running the parent package here and child one. If we refresh this, it should run two and three. I think two fails. Yeah, two fails, so it stopped. It stopped because of fault tolerance, and we can actually adjust fault tolerance in the application if that's working. Want to see if that's working? Me too. So here's my fault tolerance. Fail application on package failure. Right now it's set to true. Change that to false and save it. And let's look again. So now it's set to false there and true there and true there. Let's rerun it. Refresh this report. All right, now what's wrong? It's not running again. Did I not have the thing? So, oh, it did what I told it to. Is it doing that on purpose? Let's try again. No, it's just me. All right, child two is running. Child two is going to fail again, by the way. But you see down here, parent failed when child two failed. That's not going to happen. And child two is hard-coded to fail. That's why it's failing. But see, it failed, but parent did not. So you look at this and maybe you're saying, Andy, this looks like an awful lot just to run some packages. And you know what? If you got maybe, 10, 15 packages, SSIS packages, you're right. In fact, the catalog may be too much for that. Just run it from the command line using DT exec. You really don't need a framework. And frankly, it would introduce a bunch of overhead that if you're not familiar with the SSIS catalog already, why even go here? Just like I said, run it from the command line. So why do I like the SSIS catalog? I like it for this. I like these reports. I like being able to look at the overview of this and see, right at the very top, if it fails, there's a message that failed. And this is this is just not possible unless you're running some kind of framework, or you've got some application built to load logs from, say, flat files in, or even just open the flat file logs, whatever you have, and reading through those. When there's no failure, it doesn't matter. But I don't know if your applications just work all the time. Mine don't. And when I encounter failures, my goal is to mitigate the amount of impact to the enterprise. So I love these reports because, look, it's telling me right here, the script returned a failure result. It's letting me know exactly what happened here. Now, in this case, that's a generic message that comes when I say, script.script results equals, or how do you say it? I forget. But inside of the script task itself, you can return a script.failure. I think it's script results.failure. And when you do, it generates this very generic message. Here's the rest of the messages so you can see when that happened, kind of in the order of everything else that happened in this package. But it's right there. It's right there in front of me. And I actually like that. So, either you're never going to have anything fail, and hats off to you if that's the case. That's not been my experience with SSIS or really with anything related to computers in 46 years now of doing this. Wow, I'm old. I started when I was 11, so cut me some slack. If you got a handful of SSIS packages, don't use a framework. It's just going to frustrate you. Unless you understand how the catalog works already or you've got a framework already, then definitely use it. And you can build your own. All of us did before the catalog came out in 2012. We had like 7 years of SSIS building our own frameworks because there wasn't one. So there's that. But if you're running hundreds or maybe thousands of SSIS packages a day in your enterprise, you have something like this already. You're either using the catalog or you built an SSIS framework like the one I'm demoing here. This is a free framework, but you're managing execution in some other way. There's some automation in there somewhere. And I've seen lots of very clever solutions to do automation. I've seen things like I've seen people create a PowerShell to manage them and PowerShell to create, to automate the creation of SSIS processes inside of, say, SQL agent job steps. They have a bunch of job steps in there, stuff like that. And just automate that. So you push a button and boom, it just works. And I totally get that. And look, do what you're comfortable. If you're more comfortable with PowerShell, then do that. I like this because it's metadata driven. So if I go up here to my tables and I look at my applications. We'll just select top 1,000 rows here. We don't need 1,000 rows, so we'll just take that out. But we'll just say select those from there. And because it's just a couple fields in this particular version of it, there. So, and over here, I'm going to say package. And down here, I'm going to say packages. There. This is metadata driven. And if, metadata is actually more work. What you're doing is you're adding a step. You're storing everything in here. But if you've got hundreds or thousands of SSIS packages, metadata is your friend. This is how you drive and select what you want. And you can reuse code here, especially if you make small, tight unit of work SSIS packages. That promotes code reuse, makes it a whole lot easier to test and to troubleshoot. But the problem is, we say in engineering, there's no free lunch. The problem with having a lot of a small unit of work packages is then how then do you execute them? And so this is one answer to that. Like I said, not the only answer, but an answer. And I will almost guarantee you that that people that are running thousands of SSIS packages per day in their enterprise, they've got something that looks like this, or that's doing this. It may not be in tables. They may not be storing the metadata in tables. Maybe it's in XML or something. But this is a really cool way to store it, because then you can go after it and you can manage it by inserts and updates. And this is the free framework. Pretty soon you're going to be able to manage this by just by picking them, you know, picking them out of the list. So let's look at app four here. So we got a couple here. Let's go ahead and run an instance of app four. And let's go. Oh, it's running. That's why I need to put the spinny wheel here, don't I? There we go. Another bug. All right. I want to do a couple of things here. So the first thing I'm going to do is pause me and then step into the next statement. And so one thing I want to do is right click on here, and let's put that F9 back there, and then continue. So this will allow me to break here. I want to check a couple of things. The first thing I want to do in execute FW application is I want to put that cursor. Make cursor equal to cursors dot. And let's make this the wait cursor. That means that when I'm done, I'm in try there, and then I have a catch, and I want to do a finally. Oops. And then finally, I want to do default. There we go. Cursor.default. So that's going to reset it. The next thing I want to do is, if it's an application, then I'm going to go after the app name. And I think I've got, let's look down here. Yeah, I do have the selected application going. So after I, let's see, there's the image index. Before I read this, I want another if. If selected application dot application packages dot count is greater than zero, then and only then do I want to proceed with executing this. So let's come down to the bottom of my using here. There. So what this should do is this should set the right wait cursor. And this one, in this particular case, the application packages count should be zero. So it should get to here and jump out. And let's see what happens if, let's go ahead and take out the breakpoint and see what that looks like in real time. So, yep, and it reset the cursor there. So if we go now, actually, let's build some here. Click on F1, let's go to the catalog. Let's pick child 3 and then child 1 and save it. Click and right click. You know what? I just thought of another way to address that. So now it's right. See, we got the spinny wheel. So we're executing. It tells us we're executing down here, executing app one. And now it tells us it executed. And so if we go back and look at all executions, we should see a bigger number here. Yep, there's 8. And we just ran parent 3 and 1. Kind of cool. Okay. What I was thinking is if I right click that, I kind of got to go up here and stop. I got to pause again. I think. How does that work? Right click, yeah. Okay. And I'm going to do that check again to make sure I'm on an application. FW dot selected node image. equals two. That's an application. Then and only then do I want to go down here. Watch that. Now, watch this. See? Oh, it selected it. Son of a gun. Is that going to work? Yeah, it's in program again. Well, now that is just weird. It's kind of doing things out of order, out of the order I expected. What if we did the switcheroo here? Let's try that. It's not doing it. What's weird is it's highlighting that like it is selected. What if I give you a message here? What do you think? Conkle DC, what's the best way to ask you about getting my domain account that runs SQL Agent the permissions to run a PowerShell step inside of my DTSX package here or your email? Dave, I remember you, Pittsburgh SQL Server. Yeah. Let me bring that up. Sorry. Dave asked a really good question. Dave, here's good. But I'll answer you here since you were kind enough to ask the question. My email is andy.leonard@entdna.com. I'll put that up in just a minute. But I don't have an answer for you for this. But I'm sure I can find someone that can answer that question for you. It's a great question. By the way, it's completely valid. The best way... So you want to have a domain account that runs SQL Agent and giving that the permissions to run a PowerShell step inside of my DTSX package here or to your email. So you can email me at any time. Like I said, let me pop that up here. This is me. And feel free to email me about this question or any others. In fact, I answered that one question earlier today, a friend from LinkedIn. I don't know if you were on, Dave, when I was talking about that, but I also wrote a blog post about, not about that particular answer, but about forming the right question. That's a really great question that you asked there, Dave. That's why I say that. That's a lot of moving parts, I'll tell you, from a security perspective. And the answer may be that you don't want to do it that way, and there's some other ways to do that. Where I would go with that question, and the people I'm going to reach out to is my friends in Guys in a Cube, Adam Saxton and Patrick LeBlanc, both just genius level Power BI people. So, sorry, you asked about PowerShell, right? Let me back up. So rather than ask those guys about it, which if I had a Power BI question, the PowerShell person is Aaron Nelson. He's the guy that I go to most often. And Aaron is SQL Variant, all one word, on Twitter. And I'd reach out to Aaron, and I will. I'll reach out to that. If you just want to you want to drop that in an email to me at my email address, I'd be happy to forward that question to Aaron. It just makes it easier for me to send him questions people have sent me already. But I appreciate that question, Dave. And there's a lot of other PowerShell gurus out there. Aaron's just the one I'm friends with that pops to the top of my head. And we help each other a lot. He sends SSIS questions to me, and he and I have actually worked together some, I'd say quite a bit, on the interaction between SSIS and PowerShell. So I'm, you know, I fool around with PowerShell a little bit enough to be dangerous. The reason I don't know it any better than I do is because I know Aaron, and whenever I have a question, I send it to him and he gives me the answer. So I don't have to learn it. As long as I know Aaron. Hope that makes sense. But yeah, great. Appreciate you asking that, Dave. And I hope I didn't make you wait too long. Looks like I made you wait about 6 or 8 minutes there. Sorry about that. So here I'm going to do that same thing I did earlier with the message. And I'm going to say, an application must be selected, must first be selected. Let's try that way. Writing error messages is hard. I'm just going to leave it. Actually, no, I'll do RN select. Yeah, you know what I could do? Maybe. I think I could. Let's first be selected. Will be selected. You may proceed by right clicking the application. Yeah, I kind of like that. Okay. So first, we'll do the message box dot show thing, and we'll show that message. Actually, we'll tell it belongs to the form main here, this. Then we'll send it the message. Then we'll do the caption. That's a long caption. Then we'll do the message box buttons dot okay. Then we'll do the icon as information there. And then TVFW is the name of the tree view. And we'll say dot nodes. I think it's bracket. Yeah, 0.selected. Dot select. Nodes. No. I saw an is selected in here. I want to say it's zero. Is it, or is it this way zero? No, that's a VB way of doing it. Zero. Is selected. Is that a get set? That's just a get. Not the right one. Selected node. There we go. Equals W dot nodes dot zero. Let's try that. I'm curious if that's going to work. Let's see. So if I right click on this, it tells me, let's see, it's telling me there's my error. An application must first be selected. When you click OK, the application will be selected, and then you may proceed by right clicking. So did it do what I wanted it to do? It did. Boom. All right, so it should be running app one right now. Look at all executions. Should have just finished it. And yeah, here we go. There's app one. This is getting close to release. Let's look at app three. Let's add some goodies to app three here. Let's add one, one, and one. You can do this. This is valid. That was weird. Didn't work like I wanted. It actually did. It worked, but... So is it running three instances of child one? It did. So what I gotta work up a range-based load demo. So I keep talking about it, but it doesn't make sense until you can actually see it. App two, let's try executing you. And what it should have done there unless it should have not executed because TV mouse click menu show. These are event helpers. Execute should be right there. There it is. I need an else here. Oh, I am really sorry about that. I'm going to do the same thing here. Another string message equals has no application packages. Box.show. It belongs to this message. Buttons. Okay. Information there. Okay. It's a little chatty, but it's letting you know what's going on. There we are, 18 succeeded. It's finished. I'm digging this. It's messy still, but it's kind of clean. Clean-ish. I can put it out there for people. It's free, right? It's going to be free. And then if you don't like it, I can give you your money back. All right. I think that's good. I like it. Love your thoughts, your feedback. Please let me know what you think. You can drop me a note at my email address. If you want, you can subscribe. My hat's crooked. Well, I don't know. Maybe it's my head. If you like, you can subscribe. I'm on Facebook. Of course, you can follow me on Facebook. LinkedIn Live. You can get notifications if you connect with me there. And I connect with a lot of people. You can also on Twitch click follow and on YouTube click subscribe. And if you want to know when I'm going to do one of these, you just hit that notifications all, the little bell, and click all. It'll let you know whenever I'm up. And if not, you can always come to, I think, YouTube and Facebook. I believe LinkedIn Live. And I'm not sure about Twitch. I may not have it configured correctly. But those others, definitely they have recordings. So in about a day, this will be on YouTube. Anyway, I really want to thank you for hanging out here with me. It was a great fun for me. I hope you have a great rest of your Tuesday. And thanks again for sharing some of your time with me.